And we're back. Hey, buddies. Week two of Summer's Off. Summer's Off.
Quarantine edition.
In your closet. I do like that dirty, dirty slide.
Wow.
Just so you guys know, you can find us on
Stitcher.
You always make the most random
one. I know.
Stitcher.
I didn't even know what Stitcher is.
I mean, we're on Stitcher, yes.
Podcast app.
Podbean.
What?
That's
is that
podcast
thing?
App. I don't know.
Podbean.
Or iTunes.
Facebook.
Facebook.
A link that I'll post when we're done. I don't know. How do people find it?
They can find
You've
it anywhere.
You've obviously found
they
it, so.
They can find it anywhere.
We don't need to advertise.
Except for
how to
SoundCloud.
Find it.
That's the only place you're not going to find this. But everything else is pretty much gravy. I have to make a correction. Last week, I kept saying Man on Fire with the movie that Denzel Washington and Meg Ryan are in together.
Mm-hmm.
It was not Man on Fire.
No.
It was Courage Under Fire. They both have fire in the titles, and they both do have Denzel Washington and have a female, like...
A blonde female
who they play, he plays opposite of.
One is 10-year-old Dakota Fanning.
Yeah. I was thinking of her mom, but yeah, I guess so. Oh. That's true. That is true.
Yeah.
So, yeah, that's my mistake. Hey, and that's why you tune in. You tune in for those mistakes.
Just to be honest, no one cares, and no one even really knows what you're talking about. In fact, we're all a little confused.
Everyone's like, oh, I thought she was in Man on Fire.
Like, I could really care less about that correction.
Yeah, but it just, I knew.
It kept you up at night,
it
though.
It did. I was listening back to the podcast. I was like, why did I keep saying Man on Fire? It's Courage on Fire. I said it twice.
Yeah.
What a fool.
What a fool.
Gosh. COVID brain. Hey, how's COVID going for you?
I think we're doing okay. I'm using we. You want to know how I'm doing?
Yeah.
I'm doing okay. I'm doing pretty good.
Sweet.
Yeah.
Do you think more...
I'm trying to, like, convince myself.
Yeah, you really were.
Yeah.
Yeah. I think I'm doing okay.
I'm doing good.
Yeah. Yeah. Oh my gosh. Well, Rach, hopefully your COVID got a little bit better, your COVID madness, because we watched a spicy little flick today.
Mm-hmm.
What movie did we check out?
We checked out the classic teen film comedy romance. What is it?
Teen comedy.
Teen
yeah.
comedy. Can't hardly wait.
Yes.
Yay!
Yeah, okay. So, overall impressions.
Well, when we first discussed that we were going to go back and do some rewatches of mm-hmm. films that we both just love and we thought, like, let's just watch because I bet there's a lot of good stuff to talk about.
Mm-hmm.
When you said that you wanted to do Can't Hardly Wait, I was so excited.
Oh, good.
I haven't seen this movie in a decade. I can't say decades because I probably did, but... It's been so long, and I didn't remember what it was all about. Mm. I remembered liking it at the time, but it's one of those films that you wanted to go back and see, like, does it still hold up?
Sure.
And we, like, made bets beforehand, like, how many things are going to be offensive in this?
What was your count? Did you have a total?
I do have a total, but here's our, well, let's say, like, what our guesses were. I guessed that there was going to be, like, 8 things that were going to be offensive. Offensive things meaning, like, gay slurs
mm-hmm.
or, that's probably the biggest thing, or, like, the R word. Things
yep.
like that are just very, very prevalent
very
in
90s,
yep. early 2000s, anything, really.
Mm-hmm. I thought there was only going to be 2.
You only thought 2.
I was like, I bet there'll be 2. I bet there'll be an F-bomb, and then there'll be something else.
Yeah. I counted 5
oh,
things
that's
that
not as
I
bad.
Felt. Yeah, it
you
was.
You thought there was going to be 8, didn't you?
I did. But 5, I was, yeah, it was still. What I'll say is it was kind of the same stuff over and over again, like
mm-hmm.
a lot of homophobic slurs over and over again. I think that's probably the community that was targeted most in the 90s in these films was things like, oh, you're so gay. Yeah, like
yep,
that,
for
kind
sure.
of, that kind of humor. So.
Yep. Yeah.
Yeah,
when the cops find two guys together with their shirts off, and they're like, oh, these sickos.
Yeah.
And you're like, what sickos?
Yeah.
Come on.
Yeah.
They're not sickos.
I know.
They're just in love with each other. That's okay. It's a beautiful thing. So I want to, well, I think you should break down the movie. So for those people who haven't seen the movie, give us a little snapshot on what we're dealing with here.
All right. Picture this. You're a high school senior and you're currently sitting at your graduation. You hear the buzz on the street is there's, this is the 90s, so we say buzz on the street.
It's going to be so cool.
There's a slamming party happening tonight at so-and-so's house because her parents are out of town. It's going to be epic.
I don't know if they used epic, but I don't know. That's cool.
It's going
like
to be
it.
Major. Oh, did you also hear that the two most popular people in school broke up?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I heard that as well. This will be interesting to see how this ensues. And... scene.
Yeah. And so that's...
essentially, that's the setup for it. And then the whole movie just takes place at this party.
Mm-hmm.
You've got all of these characters intermixing and like reminiscing about high school and beyond, and a lot of people kind of making amends for things that were done or said. And it follows our protagonist, whose name I love is Preston Myers.
I love that name too.
What a name. It's just like it perfectly encapsulates who he is. He's guy next door. He's a cool guy. He's known by, like, most of the school body.
Oh, yeah,
knows
and they
him.
Like him.
He's
everybody
pretty,
likes him.
Yeah,
everybody's
he's
like,
a
Preston,
very
high-fiving him.
Likeable guy.
Him.
He, is he, like, the most popular guy? No. Is he? He's not even really in the popular crowd at all. But in this group, you do not want to be in the popular crowd.
No,
they're
no.
kind of the worst.
Yeah, but they don't bully him or anything. Like, they
no,
just, everybody's like, Preston.
Yeah, he's just kind of like an awesome everyman.
Mm-hmm.
Preston Myers. I thought this movie did so great with naming their characters. Not only that, but then, like, so the most popular girl, played by Jennifer Love Hewitt. Hewitt. I'm going to say that all
Yeah, right. I like it. That's great.
Her name was Amanda Beckett.
Ooh,
like,
how yeah.
How sweet is that?
For sure.
It's, like, such
Samuel
a
Samuel Beckett's daughter. Very fascinating.
Fascinating. And then you've got, like, the main jock, kind of, like, douchey boyfriend, and his name is two first names. Mike Dexter. Like, his is probably my most favorite name. It's like, I know exactly who this guy is.
Yep.
Mike Dexter.
Hey, what's the nerdy guy? His first name's William. Do you know his last name? Did you write that down?
I didn't write it
oh,
down,
okay.
but
okay.
I know, yeah, so many. And then, yeah, there's, like, the king of the nerds, and he's got his whole, like, revenge story going on. It's... calamity ensues, you
yep.
guys. It's a good time.
It's a good time.
Rewatch. If you haven't seen it ever, you should watch it.
Yeah, for
just
sure.
Just be, you know, mindful that it's the late 90s. So,
mm-hmm.
yeah, just know that that happened. But, yeah, it's a fun teen movie.
Mm-hmm.
It's a good time.
Yeah. So, I think you'll find this interesting. I watched this movie last right before we got together.
Oh, really?
If that informs anything, like, as far as, like, chasing after the girl your dreams, it's like, gives you the strength. I was like, yeah, we have to do this now. Fate, Preston's right, Pop-Tarts, it's all there. So, yeah, this was very much like a rah-rah movie, and one that I think I first probably came into contact with it. This came out, I think, between 5th and 6th grade for us.
Mm-hmm.
But I kind of got in contact with it 7th or 8th grade, so
okay.
a little bit later. But especially in that, you know, that time period
mm-hmm.
where you're really, like, romantic and the cool girl and you want to be with her.
Everything.
And, yep, for sure. Yep. And I think I've probably mentioned this on the podcast because we always talk about how hot people are.
Mm-hmm.
But Britney Spears was my first love, right? You know,
sure.
I had a Britney wall.
Yeah.
I had a wall of pictures.
Shrine is what we usually call
yes.
it, but yeah, a wall.
Did you have a wall, by the way?
Oh, yeah. I had a couple of walls.
Oh, I bet you did. Awesome. Who were on your walls?
Well, I didn't bow down to one deity here. I had several walls. I didn't have just one Britney shrine.
You had a pantheon of gods that you worshipped.
Yes.
Okay. Who were they? Who were some of your characters?
I had JT. I had JTT, for those of you throwing it way back. Who else did I have? Heath Ledger.
Yeah, I know one of them that you had.
Josh Hartnett.
Yep.
Oh, those were, yeah, he was probably my main squeeze.
Mm-hmm.
Josh Hartnett.
Yeah.
Oh.
So I was all about Britney, right?
Mm-hmm.
But
Brit-brat.
A close second love for me throughout all my formative years mm-hmm. was Jennifer Love Hewitt.
Yeah.
Like, she was from fourth grade, probably. Oh, I don't know if fourth grade's true, but it felt like that long. It felt like
the
first
forever.
Girl that you fall in love with, but then you meet somebody else who you fall more in love with, but she's always still there. Like throughout all of high school, even just like always loved Jennifer Love Hewitt.
Yeah.
Right up there with like Jessica Biel and stuff. You know, they're like those secondary characters in your romantic life. So this movie was always a big deal to me, mm-hmm. just because she's such a hot commodity.
When I found out that you liked this film or that you were a big fan of it, mm-hmm. I was shocked 0%. 0%, because you are such a Preston. You embody it. And I hope you take that as, like, the best, like, compliment. Mm-hmm. I mean it with love and sincerity. Like, you are such a Preston.
Okay.
And watching it, I was like, yep, that's my husband. That's my husband in high school. Jason's somebody, but he's in love.
Oh, my gosh. Okay, so explain it a little bit more. Like, get nitty gritty. What do you mean by that? Like, your husband was a Preston.
All right, so our main protagonist, Preston, right? Preston Myers, if you forgot
Preston
his name.
Preston Myers.
He's kind of an everyman. He's a hopeless romantic, and he is in love with Jennifer Love Hewitt's character. And he's loved her since the first day he saw her. But, like, he's more into her than she's just pretty. He thinks that she's more than just the cheerleader. She's more than just, you know, Mike Dexter's girlfriend. Like, mm-hmm. he thinks that she has, like, a beautiful soul. He just feels, like, a connection to her.
Sure.
Then, I'm sitting in class, enjoying a late breakfast, when suddenly, out of all the classrooms in the entire school, she walks into mine. And where does the teacher sit her? Right next to me. Now, up until now, one could write this off to coincidence. But then, she reached into her bag and pulled out a strawberry Pop-Tart. The very same breakfast pastry that I was consuming at that moment.
And he, like, looks for, like, all of these signs and these, like, symbols that mean, like, we should be together throughout it all. And I don't know, just, like, you know, showing up to the party, like, people all know him, and he's just very lovable, you know. So that's what I mean
by that. Oh, you're so lovable. Thank you. Thanks. That's very, very kind. Did you at all feel like... you're kind of full of shit. Like, was there ever a moment with Preston where you're like, you don't even know this person?
Oh, absolutely. Absolutely. I think, yeah, his character, and I think, so there's a moment later on in the film when Jennifer Love Hewitt is, like, trying to exit the party, and everyone found out that, like, she's officially broken up with, and, like, all of these guys keep trying to come up to her, and they're like, hey, you want to hang out mm-hmm. with me? Hey, and unfortunately, bad timing for Preston, he comes up, and he's like, I gotta tell you, I love you. And she's like, who do you? And she goes off on him. She's like, who do you think you are? It's a really great monologue. We actually mm-hmm. should pull maybe a little bit of it, even though it's not that funny.
That is enough. God, I haven't even been single for like 5 minutes. And already you think that I am just gonna strip off my clothes and do you right here because I don't know. I don't know. You imagine that we shared some intimate moment that you have probably been drooling over for the past 4 years. God, you know, how sick and deluded are you? You know what? Why don't you just go off and get yourself a goddamn life, asshole?
Maybe we won't. But it's just, like, she goes off on him, and it's all, like, rightfully so. She's like, I don't know who you think you are. You don't mm-hmm. know me. I don't owe you anything. Like, you've been obsessing about some moment. Like, you're creeping me out. Like, mm-hmm. like, stop. Everyone just stop. Like, I am not, like, something to be, like, coveted, and, like, you don't know me, so don't, yeah, I don't know. It was.
No, for sure.
Yes. I'm paraphrasing extremely.
You know, I didn't do that at all during
the... You don't know me. You get out of here.
You know, you need to get these quotes right on like I did with You Got Mail.
Yeah, you were really...
It was really important to nail the quotes. Otherwise, the audience does not understand
They'll
what you're saying.
They'll never know.
Yeah. So, if you had to guess who wrote and directed this, and they did other teeny bopper movies around this time period, would you be able to guess, not the person, but what movie they would have directed? I mean, I can tell you the directors. They're Harry Elfont and Deborah Kaplan.
Uh-uh. No bells, but you want me just to list off some other teen
movies?
Just list off
another teen movie that you're like, maybe.
She's All That.
No. That's a good guess,
Ten Things I Hate About You.
Mm-mm.
I got it, and I got nothing.
Okay. You weren't going to get it.
How?
Josie and the Pussycats.
No! Yeah. That film.
Josie and the Pussycats was their other big film that they did.
Yeah.
And think about it. Some of the characters that are in this movie as, like, mm-hmm. these bit roles, they're all in Josie and the Pussycats. Like, the entire band Du Jour. Do you remember Du Jour and Josie and the Pussycats?
Yeah,
they sing
vaguely.
That back door. You're my back door, baby. Or something like that. You don't know that?
No.
So they are Backdoor Lover, I think is what it's called.
All
the Du Jour guys, they're all in this movie. It's the dude, it's the friend from Scrubs, Zach Braff's buddy,
mm-hmm.
and Seth Green,
mm-hmm.
and the guy who's in the leader of the band, who's yep. also in like Old School and stuff.
Mm-hmm.
Or not Road Trip, I mean.
Yeah.
They're all in that band.
It's kind
together.
Of like the 90s who's who
yep.
of guys in their 20s.
For sure. For
yeah.
sure.
Mm-hmm. I'm your backdoor lover. From behind all the lights.
And this writer director duo, the thing that they had done right before this, so Josie and the Pussycats was after,
okay.
but right before this, they wrote da da da, a very Brady sequel.
Oh, the Brady?
They wrote the stupid Brady Bunch sequel
but not,
movie.
But the
not the first one.
Which
they
was,
weren't good
I think
enough
it was
for the
really
first
good.
One.
I've seen that movie a lot. It's been a while, but that was one of those random VHSs that my grandma had. The Brady,
how many
the
VHSs
Brady
did she have?
It was a cabinet full. A cabinet full. I don't remember the sequel as much, but I remember the first one. Oh, that's interesting. And that kind of tells me, like, it knows, they kind of know what they are then. They're a little,
yeah.
like, tongue-in-cheek about their movies. They're, like, kind of, like, poking fun at the same time. Like,
mm-hmm.
it doesn't, like, this movie does not take itself seriously. In fact, it makes fun of teens in general,
mm-hmm.
and the cliches at our high school and parties at high school. So I really appreciate that about it.
Well, let's talk about why they chose to do the movie that they chose to do.
Okay.
So they were trying to think of a plot line that would involve very little expenses.
Mm.
They wanted something that was cheap being their first project, mm-hmm. and the studio wanted something cheap as well. And they're like, okay, so if we can limit this to like one setting, I feel like that would be really good. Like we're just in one place the entire movie. And another idea, like, oh, well, what if right now there hasn't been any, like, teen movies lately? Like, we had this 80s infusion of teen movies.
Yeah, John Hughes.
Yeah, with all the John Hughes flicks.
Mm-hmm.
And the last teen movie was, like, Dazed and Confused. I think it already came out. And, well, maybe not. I didn't actually look up that year. Maybe not.
Hmm.
But Scream was, like, a huge teen success, like, a couple years earlier.
Yeah, and I don't think of that as a teen movie.
Like a teen
but
comedy.
But for that audience.
But with Scream being such a big deal, they were like, we got to get into this teen movie game. Like, this is where the money's at. And then they had this whole idea for this rage and party, and then it can stay in, like, a static set and just be in one area.
Mm-hmm.
And so it was a way for them to, like, save money. That was their whole reasoning. Hey, so some of the tropes that are involved in this movie, like getting stuck into a bathroom. You didn't have a bathroom that you'd get stuck in. You had a bathroom that didn't close at your house.
Well, here's the thing. It did close when you close and you got stuck in it.
So
that's why you leave it
open.
Oh,
you did have one there you got stuck
in. Yeah, and old houses, you know, doors are funky.
Is there anything? Oh, so while we're talking about this, there's a scene in the movie where two characters get stuck into a bathroom.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't know if you've had this experience where you've been at somebody's house and you've asked to use their restroom,
mm-hmm.
and you go in and the door like doesn't open right away. Have you ever had this like with an old door?
Uh-uh.
Oh my God. It's horrifying. You seriously
you're
think
there.
You're going to get stuck in there. You're like jiggling the handle and you can tell everyone's right outside like in the kitchen
yeah.
and you're in the kitchen bathroom or whatever.
Sure.
And so they're listening to you struggle and you can sometimes hear their giggles and it keeps the anxiety ramping up. It's horrible. I hope this never happens to you. It is truly
well,
terrible.
I'll say
it's happened to me multiple times.
Multiple times.
Yes, for sure. Horrible.
What I'll say is, I don't know if I'm going to like worry about them hearing me struggle on the outside.
Well,
you
then
so
they'll
I'm
always
concerned.
Say things too. They'll be like, here, you got to turn it really hard or something like that. Or they'll mm-hmm. be like, don't do it so hard. Or like they're trying to give you feedback and you really in your head all you're hearing is, I'm getting trapped, I'm getting trapped, I'm getting trapped. Everyone hears me. Everyone's laughing. Everyone hates me.
Oh, man. That, there's something else going on there.
Yeah,
that's...
there's a lot of anxiety. And you know what? It might have been caused by this movie. I don't know. It could
that's
have been
possible.
Yeah, planted the seed for anxiety-ridden experiences in the future. But that whole trope in this movie was decided because one of the writers, mm-hmm. she had a friend mm-hmm. who she threw this crazy rager when she graduated and at her parents' house when they were gone. Mm-hmm. And one of her friends got stuck in the bathroom upstairs. And she had told her, like, hey, make sure the bathroom door doesn't close. Mm-hmm. It closed. And then she was stuck in there. And they were all too drunk downstairs that they didn't hear her. Oh, and then everybody passed out. And they had to let her out.
Then, no.
And then a snake came out of the toilet, an anaconda.
What?
And it ate her while deadly spiders filtered in from the window. It was wild. But no, so she was trapped in there for multiple hours. Oh, they let her out the next morning when they found her.
Oh, man.
Yep. So that was based on real life events.
That does sound terrible.
I'm so happy you have not had that experience.
I mean, not for that
feeling
long.
You're going to get trapped in the bathroom.
I think I've always been on the other side of the door, which is also scary, too. One of my siblings got stuck in their bedrooms at one point.
What a loser. Which one was it?
I don't know. Probably Zach.
Zach, you're such an idiot.
He probably slammed the door or something.
Because he's so moody.
I don't know. Something like that happened where a door got shut really hard, and then it was one of those glass doorknobs, and it was like, uh-oh. And it just keeps spinning and spinning.
And then the handle falls off. So Dazed and Confused did happen before this movie.
Okay.
Because I'm seeing in my notes that they stole lines from Dazed and Confused to put in this movie.
Oh, really?
One of those lines. And so I don't know if it was more of an homage to it or what it was.
Sure.
But they would take certain lines from the movie, and one of them was about, like, Scooby-Doo. It was Jason Segel.
Yeah.
Steven Seagal.
He's in this movie?
Yeah, he made a cameo. Who's in the background? He jumps into the pool.
There were so many cameos.
There are. It's
That's insane.
So Jason Segel mm-hmm. is the watermelon man. He's like licking watermelon the whole time.
It's
weird. Weird-ass character. And he talks, and his buddy is like stoned, and they're looking at the stars or whatever, and mm-hmm. he goes, you know who's really hot? Is Velma off Scooby-Doo. She never got much play. That chick's a really cool babe or something like that. Mm-hmm. That was stolen from Dazed and Confused, but it was about Martha Washington. So they had stole this thing from that movie, and they put it in theirs.
Fascinating.
Yep. Have you ever seen Dazed and Confused?
I don't think so.
Okay.
Because I have Matthew McConaughey in it.
Yes, that's the famous line.
I've seen chunks of it, but I haven't, not all the way through.
They keep getting older. I keep getting older. They stay the same age. Yeah. That's from that movie.
And that's probably why I haven't seen this movie.
Oh, it's good.
Is it?
Yeah, well, it's weird.
Yeah.
It's good, though.
It sounds
it's good
weird.
It's like this
it's
movie
good,
only,
weird.
Only it takes place in the 70s, but it's still a 90s movie.
Sure.
That's pretty much what it is.
I gotcha.
There was tons of young actors that mm-hmm. were becoming super famous around this time. And you had this just dearth of young talent that auditioned for this movie. And one of the reasons was there wasn't any teen movies that were happening at the time.
Mm-hmm.
Who do you want to talk about first?
Oh, my gosh. There's so...
It's crazy.
So many.
And you can just say a character, too.
Let's talk about... I mean, I thought Seth Green was really excellent in this movie. Now, what I'll say is his character is offensive, right?
Tell him about his character.
He's like this white boy who is just like all about appropriation.
For
and
sure.
just like
takes on characteristics of black culture.
Yeah, yeah. He's got his hair like kind of in dreads, and it's kind of 90s style too. So like big mm-hmm. baggy pants, you know, blah, 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 blah.
Yep. He's wearing Tommy Hilfiger at one point, though. I used to wear Tommy.
Yeah, just like, and just his speech and everything is just very like over the top. But I think it pokes fun at itself too. Like mm-hmm. it knows that,
for
like,
sure.
And he gets called out and he's like, hey, like, that's like, you're an idiot.
Yeah.
You're being offensive. Stop. Mm-hmm. So I will give that to it. But at first as I was watching the movie begin, I was like, oh, that's right, this character. Ooh,
yep.
I was like a little cringy. But then I settled into it because I was like, okay, we're making fun of mm-hmm. that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, except for his friends use the N-word at one point in the movie.
Yeah.
And he gets chased by a bunch of dudes.
Yeah.
It's like, ooh.
Yeah, that slapped me in the face. That
yep.
came out of nowhere. I was like,
yep.
whoa.
I mean, they're like, they don't use the N-word in a cool way. They use the N-word and then they get like punished for it. There's consequences for their actions. But still, it's just like super weird.
It came out of nowhere.
Yeah, you didn't need to do that part.
Whoa.
So Seth Green... He was not a big deal at this time.
Oh,
like,
yeah.
he, I don't think he had started Buffy yet. Like, I have in my notes that he really hadn't done a whole lot. He auditioned for William, actually. William is, like, the nerdy character. Yep. So that was the first...
It would have been fun as that, too.
That was his main audition, and he lost that role.
Mm-hmm.
And then they were like, well, we have this other character that would be perfect for this guy.
Mm-hmm.
And so they brought him in, and they just kind of changed what they were kind of looking at him for. But, yeah, he wasn't even going for that character to start with.
Oh, it's so funny. He's like, his stature, too, plays so much into it. Like, mm-hmm. he's so short.
He's crazy short.
And it just, like, really amps up the fact that he's like, this little person trapped in the body who mm-hmm. just wants to be big and tall and taken seriously.
Yeah, because Lauren Ambrose, who he plays opposite of, who's, like, kind of like the gothy, super smart best friend to Preston.
Yeah, yeah. She's kind of just alternative.
Yep.
Like,
yeah, I guess not gothy. That's not
she's
right.
She's not goth, but she's alternative. She listens to, you know, Smashing Pumpkins.
Yeah,
or, you know,
yep.
That's who she's into.
Mm-hmm. She's a grunge baller, as we would say back in my day. Grunge baller type.
That's not
Shout
a thing.
Out to You Got Mail episode of
That's
what we're
not
talking
a thing.
About. But she's fairly short. And Seth Green is shorter than she is.
Yeah.
Like, it's mm-hmm. it really hammers home how short he is. Mm-hmm. I should have looked that up.
You should have. That would have been a great fact. Listeners, please call in and
give
us know.
How tall is
Seth Green?
All right. Who do you want to go to next? There's so many characters. So
I
had to limit what I wrote down.
I mean, I don't know. Let's
talk about Preston.
Okay.
All right. So Preston's played by a guy named Ethan Embry. Do you mm-hmm. know him from any other films?
He looks so familiar.
Mm-hmm.
He's got a face that just looks so familiar because he's an Every guy,
yep.
right? I imagine that his hairline looks much different. I think he already had a receding hairline in high
yep.
school, and I was like, oh.
Well, he's not in high school in this movie.
No, I know but... that, but like as a high school playing
mm-hmm.
character, he already had a receding hairline, so I can only imagine where it's at now. But
yep, it's true. I saw pictures of him today.
Yeah,
his hair has continued to recede.
Yeah,
he had a lot of hair in a movie that was just a year before this, and I wonder if you'll have seen it. So, well, let me go through kind of his catalog.
Yeah,
he was in All I Want for Christmas as a kid.
Mm-mm.
Do you know that movie? They like nope. kidnap Santa because they want Santa to help them get their parents back together who are divorced or whatever. I don't know. Sounds cute, but I've never even
That's
heard
adorable.
Of it.
Adorable.
Yeah. Never even heard of it. What's that movie with JTT? What's that
I'll
movie?
Be home for Christmas.
I'll be home for Christmas. Okay.
Another adorable film.
No, I don't know if adorable is the right terminology. I think that movie's kind of lame. But then he was in Empire Records, which is on our list,
mm-hmm.
but you have never seen
it. I have not seen it, but I know of it.
Yep.
Yeah.
Yep. So that is a movie that I think we'll get to eventually down the road. And then he was in, this is one you're going to kick yourself about, That Thing You Do.
Oh, he's
yep.
the original drummer.
Yes,
that
he's the
drummer. That breaks his arm.
Yep.
Oh, mm-hmm. and he gets kicked out of the band. Oh, he's so cute.
Yep.
Oh, poor guy.
And then right before this, he was in Vegas Vacation.
Oh, is he the kid?
He's the brother. He's the young son.
Was he the young son always, or is he?
No.
No,
they
used a new
him
actor,
for Vegas.
Right, when he got older.
Yep. He's the one who, like, everything he touches, he, like, wins big.
Yeah.
And so he'll throw yep. dice, and he wins and craps, and he has to get a fake ID, and then he keeps winning at everything. He
gotcha.
Has a car and stuff.
Yep.
Yep.
There it is.
So, but he had tons more hair in that movie, and that was just, like, a year before this.
Times they are changing.
Dude, oh, well,
it
I
happens.
Was just telling you today, my gray hair is going from the side of my head to the top of my head at a furious pace.
It is all over. So we, little side note, we cut Ty's hair yesterday. I say we, I cut Ty's hair yesterday because it was time.
Yep.
And you almost had like a stripe down like the center of your head that is coming in extra gray as we were, as I was like spray bottling and, you know, quaffing and whatnot. It just looked like there was like this like lightning streak down the middle. So it's moving from the temples up to the top and all over.
I need that Pretty Woman musical to hit fast.
It looks great.
So Ethan Embry, Preston,
mm-hmm.
he was actually initially cast as William, the nerd.
No, really?
Yeah. He was cast
he
as William Lichter.
He just doesn't have the body type.
I have the last name. William Lichter.
Yep. Yep,
that's a great nerd name. So William Lichter, and
so easily bullied, unfortunately.
And then they also had offered, like, if you don't want to play that role, one of the nerdy friends who sit on top of the roof as well.
Oh.
And he wouldn't accept it. He said, no, I'm sick of playing these goofy side characters, and I want to play the guy who gets the girl.
Mm-hmm.
That's what he, like, pitched to the producers. He's like, I want to be the guy who gets the girl.
Mm-hmm.
And they relinquished it, and they're like, yeah, you got it.
Well,
and
yeah.
So just pitching it to him actually worked, which makes me think, that's what I'm going to do in casting from here on out. Just going to say, like, I'm an audition, and then I'm going to go to their office before they post the cast list, mm-hmm. and I'm going to be like, here's why I need to play this character.
I don't know if that's going to work out.
Yeah.
But kudos to him for sticking to his guns and knowing, because he perfectly fits this
role.
For
sure.
I can't imagine, I mean, just body type wise, and I know because the guy who they had play William Lichter is so much, like, physically tinier mm-hmm. and skinnier.
He's so skinny.
I don't know who this guy is. I've never seen him in anything else, but he's such a goof. He's really good.
That guy was in other movies. He was in, this is one you're going to know, well, you won't know this one. He was in Dick Tracy as the kid.
Oh, okay.
But then he was also.
Oh, wait.
He was in Hook.
Yes.
He's a kid.
He was a cute little kid.
For sure.
Oh.
Yep. That's him grown up.
What?
And now, interesting fact, he is a lawyer for an entertainment firm.
Okay.
And then in 2011, when Obama was president,
mm-hmm.
Obama assigned him to this very special, like, panel of people that oversaw, like, small businesses and things.
Okay.
And so he worked technically in the Obama administration.
Whoa.
Yeah.
Is he cute now?
I don't think so, but you could look him up.
I feel like he could, like, pack a couple of pounds on and, like,
fill out
his hair
a
little bit. I think it could be really cute.
Yeah, you're all about changing those nerdy guys into stellar
dudes,
though.
I think there's a project to be had there.
So back to Embry.
Yes.
Preston.
Yep.
He was a world-class gymnast.
What?
Now, tell me in the movie... Was there anything that you ever saw that you're like, oh, that could use a world-class gymnast to be able to pull off that magical feat?
Are you kidding? Yeah, there's a moment, a random, like, wide shot of the front of the house, kind of towards the end of the party when things are, you know, I mean, it's still raging, right? And you see this, like, person just, like, do this whole sequence of, like, flip back to roundabout, rond de jambe. These aren't things.
Yeah, no, I got you.
Triple sow cow.
Triple stock out, stick to landing, boom. Yes, for sure.
That was him?
That was him. And you know what's funny is I watched the shot, and I saw him doing those backflips on the yard, and then he's walking up. Like, then they cut to him walking up to
the
party.
Yeah, I was
like, he's going to see himself flipping. But that was actually, he was just messing around out on the lawn,
what?
And they just recorded it, and they were like, yeah, let's use that.
Let's do it. We can't tell it's him. Oh, Preston, you're looking for Preston? Yeah, he's the amazing gymnast that's out on the front lawn. I can't believe you don't know who he is, Jennifer Love Hewitt. He's amazing. Have you seen his tuck jumps?
If you don't know who he is, just say, who can do a backflip out here? He'll show himself right away.
Oh, Preston can. Yeah, I'm surprised he didn't stand out more to her. I just think that's...
Well, another thing about Embry, he was a huge, huge, huge... stoner.
Oh.
And he was high almost the entire shoot.
Oh, really?
Yep. He was always high. And he never... Oh, this is going to really bum you out because it bummed me out.
Yeah.
He never read the script.
What?
He didn't read the script. He just memorized his lines and called it good.
He went up to bat and, like, said, like,
that's why I think this is so bizarre.
This role, and
uh-huh.
yet, like, then he did no work for it,
yep.
and
he just
like,
wanted the character. He wanted the idea of it.
No,
he never read the script, and then get
this—it's all confirmed. Are we sure?
He said it in an interview.
He said it.
Yeah,
oh,
this is from
no.
him. And then also, he has never seen the movie all the way through.
What?
He walked out of the premiere or whatever to go party and have fun.
Whoa!
Yeah,
he is. He is not a Preston.
Dude,
you know
I know.
He is. He's Mike Dexter. That's
Dexter.
That's who he is in
no,
real life.
I'm going to tell you more things.
No.
And you're going to get more and more bummed as we go along.
Oh, that hurt my heart a
yep.
little bit.
And speaking of Mike Dexter,
yeah.
let's go to Mike Dexter next.
Mike Dexter.
Kiss my ass!
Mike Dexter is played by Peter Facinelli, and he started his audition for the role of Mike Dexter doing push-ups.
Yep.
For the casting director.
Yeah.
And he, right before they went into filming, became a dad.
Oh.
Yup.
Intentionally?
Yeah, I don't know. Probably.
Is that a whoop-de-doo?
No, I don't know.
Did he get that detail. Cheerleading captain pregnant at high school? Or?
No, so Peter...
Such a Mike Dexter thing to do.
Peter Vaginelli had just had a baby.
Okay.
And actually, right before they started shooting, the baby had long fingernails.
Oh.
And it scratched him in his eyeball.
Oh,
and
gosh.
His eye was swollen shut. And so there are, and I didn't notice this in the shots.
No.
But there are shots that are taken where you only see half of his face because his eyes were swollen shut.
Oh, no. His baby scratched him.
Because his baby scratched him. He was worried he was going to have to drop the role.
Yeah.
And they had actually kind of had preliminary talks about that. They're like, what are we going to do about him?
Mm-hmm.
Are we going to have to go with somebody else or not? And they're like, no, we can get around it to give him a couple days to heal. And he was able to make it. After like a couple days.
Yeah. So. Fascinating. You know how you said that, you know, they wanted to have like a set that was easy so that they could just kind of keep all the filming in one thing? I think sometimes when films take place over one night.
Like Superbad?
Yeah. I tend to think that the filming is very short. Like it only takes like a week.
Sure. I think that's
or
fair though.
3 nights to do it. I know that's not the case.
Not that short.
Sometimes they're like, oh yeah, we just filmed this all in one night. We just hopped around. We filmed all your scenes. Okay, now you guys can go. Now we film all your scenes in this room. I know that's not how filming works. But I tend to think it goes real fast.
I'm pretty sure I have it on here, but I think it was like a 20-something day shoot.
Okay.
Like 24 days or 28 days or something like that.
That seems too long. I could do it in half the time, I think.
Yeah, it was the pool. It was all the pool shots. Because you have to wait for people to dry to set up for the next take.
Yeah,
otherwise,
no.
They look silly.
Cut the pool.
No
cut
pool.
The time.
Put cement in the pool. We don't want it. Another thing about Peter Facinelli. Did you recognize him from another movie?
Yeah, but I don't know what.
He's older.
Yeah.
He plays... A dad.
Another dad.
Yep, but not a dad to little kids. He's like a dad to a bunch of teenagers. And some would debate he's not really their biological dad. But he takes care of them. He's a doctor. He has blonde hair.
He's in Twilight?
He's in Twilight.
Oh,
he's Carlisle.
God. What? I'm sorry. I know the mic's going crazy. We'll have to edit this. Whoa.
Yeah. The douchebag becomes... The dad who everybody loves in Twilight.
Blonde hair and orange eyes. I didn't recognize him as a vampire.
Yep. That's him.
Oh my gosh.
Rachel's really taking this in. This is
a
huge moment.
That was insane. I'm sorry.
We have a boom a boom arm now for our mic. And so would drop the mic, but it's currently connected to a boom arm.
Slap the mic.
Slap the mic every time something crazy happens.
I don't know about you guys, but that was a crazy truth bomb that just got dropped. That was nuts. What?
Yeah.
Carlisle.
So there were other characters in this movie as well, like Melissa Joan Hart is in this movie.
Yes.
She plays like the yearbook friend.
Mm-hmm.
And
she's real spazzy.
She is.
Mike Jackson, you have to sign my yearbook. Which team has the winning black?
Melissa Joan Hart was a huge deal at this time.
I was going to say, because this was after Clarissa Explains It All. So she had her own TV show on Nickelodeon, which I watched a lot.
Yeah, she was doing...
Was she doing Sabrina yet?
She was doing Sabrina at this time.
Oh.
So she was huge.
Was she pissed that she wasn't the main chick in this?
No, and in fact, they had approached her, and they were like, we want you to be in this movie. Mm-hmm. And they had some bigger roles, and she was like, with my work schedule, I can't.
Sure.
But I want to be a part of it.
Yeah.
She was friends with several people who were in the cast.
Okay.
And her and J-Lo were buddies.
Mm-hmm.
And so she was like, I want to be a part of it. Is there anything for me? And they're like, well, we have this bit part. And she's like, perfect. I want to do it.
Okay.
And so she was totally game and on board with it.
Now, that is really cool, Melissa Joan Hart. She just wanted to be a part of it, even though she was a big deal. And she could have just said, like, nope. Yeah, and yeah, Sabrina... I was going to say Sabrina Explains It All. I just missed her two shows.
What would that show be like?
Sabrina and Clarissa Explains It All. Yeah, when you have, like, your own show that you were, like, the title character of, that's pretty cool.
Mm-hmm.
That's really cool.
Now, her and Jennifer Love Hewitt, they were...
Hewitt.
They were buddies, and... They had these late night shoots, right? Because pretty much the whole film takes place overnight. So they'd have all these late night shots, and they would get really, really tired.
Mm-hmm.
And so she had all these B12 vitamins that she gave Jennifer Love Hewitt. Ooh. And Jennifer Love Hewitt was like, I don't know, is this okay? Mm-hmm. Am I going to get in trouble for taking these? She's like, no, they're just vitamins. They're like caffeine or whatever. Uh-huh. They popped all these B12s. Uh-huh. And Jennifer Love Hewitt said they got high on these B12s.
Oh.
I don't know if you really can get high on B12s. We'll have to get Fauci on, but like that sounds pretty crazy. And Jennifer Love Hewitt said that they would just stand there and they would stare at these owls in these trees for like hours.
What owls?
Her and Melissa Joan Hart.
There were real
owls?
There
were owls in this tree, and they would just stare at
There's
them.
Not owls out there on the set. Fake owls?
But is the question that they were so high they were seeing
oh
owls.
My gosh.
And I think you just brought it up.
That's...
Exactly.
That's crazy. So they were essentially on speed for
yeah,
the whole
much.
Making
pretty
of
much.
This. Oh.
Speaking of Jennifer Love Hewitt, let's get into her a little bit.
Let's.
What's the earliest thing you remember her from?
Character-wise? I mean, the youngest, I feel like, is... I don't know. I didn't watch... What was her show? Party of Five?
She was in Party of Five.
Yeah, I didn't see. That was kind of before my time, but I knew she was in that. And that was before this, mm-hmm. right?
Yep, yep.
So I guess I've seen clips of her in that. But otherwise, it's like, really, this movie is, like, early J-Love mm-hmm. for me.
Yeah.
I can't think of anything else.
So... She was also in Disney Incorporated, so she was a Disney kid.
Oh, like
and
a Mouseketeer type of
so.
Thing?
Yeah. I don't remember Disney Incorporated
yeah.
at all.
Her and Britt and JT
oh.
and a lot of other people.
Can you imagine her and Brittany in the same room?
Can you?
Who would I talk
have
to?
You? Yes, you have. Let's not answer that question.
This is a PG-13 podcast. So she was in a big, huge movie right before this. She was in one of the first movies, scary movies I ever saw.
Yeah, I know.
I know what you did last
That was
summer.
Before this?
That was right before
oh,
this.
Oh, she was big then.
So she filmed that movie, mm-hmm. and then when she started filming Can't Hardly Wait, before it got, well, I think it was after they had done filming, but before that movie got released, I Know What You Did Last Summer got released, so she exploded.
Yeah.
And then Can't Hardly Wait released, and so the producers were super happy. They were
oh,
like, oh, yeah,
yeah
she's
so
a huge deal
this
now.
This is great.
This is going to be awesome.
This is awesome.
Yep.
Wow.
She
wow.
was in another movie before this, and I have seen this movie. It's called Trojan War. Rach?
Shoot.
What's the movie Trojan War about?
Well, can I ask a question?
Yes,
can
you
I
may.
Just, like, remind me?
Yep.
Is this the historical
Here's
version
what I'm gonna say.
Of the Trojan War movie, or is this the contemporary telling of the story?
It's not like Troy. There's no Eric Bana.
Okay.
There's no Orlando Bloom. This is Trojan War. And think she's in high school.
Yeah.
So let that.
All right. So Trojan War was essentially like the first Bring It On film. The high school's mascot were the Trojans, obviously.
Oh, okay.
And this was a cheerleading team who was down on their luck because their choreographer twisted her ankle before the big competition and she couldn't remember the steps. Because she also got hit on the head. And so the team had to come together in order to win this war, this dance battle, and they had to come up with the dance together. And I don't want to spoil any more of it for you.
Well,
yep.
That must be the sequel, because the first one has Eric, the brother from Boy Meets World.
Oh, okay. Yeah.
And they play opposite of each other.
They'd be cute opposite each other.
And the movie is much more sophomoric than you thought.
Oh.
Trojans.
Oh.
It's all about how Eric wants to go find a condom because his girlfriend's finally going to have sex with him. And he's searching all over the city looking for condoms. And they're out everywhere. And he goes through all these shenanigans to get to have sex with Jennifer Love Hewitt.
Mm.
So.
Got it.
And I've seen it.
And you've seen it.
I've seen that movie.
And how many stars would you give it?
I would give it, don't remember how many stars. But I don't remember me being like, that movie's the best.
That was amazing.
When you said that, your eyes kind of crossed, which made it really great. It's kind of amazing.
Amazing.
Let's talk about Lauren Ambrose. She's who plays Denise, the best friend
yeah.
to Preston, mm-hmm. and hooks up with Seth Green in the movie. She's Italian.
Oh, really?
Would you have guessed that?
So let me describe Lauren for you.
Sure.
Lauren is pale as the day is long. She is like sateen off of Moulin Rouge pale. Like
sure.
She's got blue veins coming mm-hmm. out everywhere.
Yep.
And very, very red copper hair. Like
for
you
sure.
know it's probably initially real and then she like put extra red on top of it to make
sure. I don't know if she does. She looks like that in 6 Feet Under. She's in that. She looks like that in so many things.
She's either red or she's like white blonde. Those are her. Because she doesn't have eyebrows. She doesn't have eyebrows.
I know. I'm telling you. I think she's got orange hair.
Okay. That could be. Her hair, her eyebrows are so faint. But she's pretty.
She is.
She's very pretty.
And she hates the haircut that she had in this movie. She says it's horrible.
Did she hate it at the time?
I don't know. She makes fun of it now.
Because I'll be honest, it's the 90s, and we all hate what we did.
Ooh.
When we look back at our hair.
Do you have a story you'd like to share?
I mean, just like, well, actually, yeah, I did that to my hair. And I had her hair, minus the bangs on the front, but like that kind of, it's not a bob. It's like a flip almost. It's like a very short Rachel Green off of Friends flip '90s hair. So like the top like comes down and is curled under, and then you've got this like bottom layer that like flips out. It's like kind of like mom hair now, but then it was kind of cool at a younger age.
Do you have any pictures of this that you could share with our Summer's Off audience on our Facebook page?
Oh, I'll have to enlist some help of my mom. Mom, it's my 7th grade year. I had just cut my hair and it was Valentine's Day and I curled it. That's where you're really going to see the flips. Maybe even my 13th birthday would be a really good picture, actually. I bet. Yeah, I'll find it.
Okay. I think it'd be fun.
I'll enlist some help.
Yep. And then, as always, encourage you to, besides telling us your funny screen names that you had back when you had AOL from You've Got Mail, this would be fun as well. Terrible hair decisions that you made in your past.
Oh, yeah.
I got some doozies.
You got, you have.
I had blonde hair, baby.
You got blonde hair. Yep. And that was middle school for you as well?
No, that was 9th grade. I was too old for that choice.
Too old for
I actually
that.
Didn't start dyeing my hair until 8th
like
grade. I was way late to the game. It was horrible.
Oh, so good.
So she is a trained opera singer, though.
Oh.
Yeah, and in fact, she was... What? What were you going to say?
She was recently in something, wasn't she?
Yeah, she was. What's she in?
She was My Fair Lady?
Yes.
Yes!
She got nominated for a Tony.
Whoa, another... Brain exploding. Whoa, I knew I had seen her from that.
Yep. And you saw some episodes of 6 Feet Under.
I did. Yeah, I never recognized her from that too. But I had forgotten that, that she was in that as well.
Did you feel like she's a Molly Ringwald of this movie?
Well, the hard thing is that Molly Ringwald is the lead in her movie.
Sure.
So she is not in that respect, but I could see that they maybe wanted to try to go that route where they wanted a character that kind of embodies a Molly Ringwald-ish thing. Ah, yeah. If she had like her own spinoff, she could definitely be the Molly Ringwald. I could see it. I thought of Molly Ringwald when I saw her, just red hair, like just very, and even just where she's at in most of her movies in the popularity scale. She's kind of like in that in-between.
Sure.
Yeah, she's not the nerd. She's not the jock. She's just like, she's just Molly.
So in other movies of 80s ilk, like this obviously inspired this film. What we would have seen is we would have seen Preston go after Jennifer Love Hewitt, right? And then when Amanda shuts Preston down, he would have then found love back with his best friend.
Yeah.
He would have realized, oh, this is the person I need to be with. And then they would have ended up together at the end of the movie. Kind of like Teen Wolf. We talked about that plot line in Teen Wolf.
Exactly like Teen Wolf. Tune in to season 2, episode 1 for that little nugget.
So did you like that they didn't go that route? Or did you think that that route would have made more sense because Preston just is in love with this Amanda character from afar?
It's
a little philosophy. He loves Thoreau. Let's get Thoreau up in here.
I did like the beginning where they all had like their yearbook quotes is Thoreau, and there's a lot of great
hers is true
quotes.
Friends stab you in the front, which I love. That's what that's what Ambrose's thing is, Lauren.
Both is my answer.
So you could have seen it go either way.
I could have seen it go either way, and I would have liked it both. It would have made sense both ways. What I'll say is if he would have gone for the friend, I would have needed more of a build up between them, obviously. We need to flush that out. We need to have more moments of her or him like longing for the other one a little bit, or you know, missed opportunities, things like that needed to come up more. Their connection needed to be stronger if they were going to go that route. So because they didn't, he had to have a moment with J-Love Mm-hmm. There at the end.
Yeah.
Now, what I will say is, does, like, the kiss at the end feel a little weird because, like, they just met type of thing?
You mean between Jennifer Love Hewitt and
Preston?
Yeah. Yep.
A little bit. Like, I want them to, like, spend some time, but I almost wanted him to... So he's catching a train, and he's going away, right? And she just, like, finally got a hold of him and realized that he's not a jerk, and he wrote her this great letter, and she's like, "You're leaving now?" And she's like, "Maybe it just, you know, that wasn't meant to be." And then he decides, okay, no, I'll, you know, maybe I can go on a later train, which I love all of that. I want him at that point to be like, "Do you want to go, like, get coffee?
Exactly.
You want to go get coffee? You want to go talk?" But instead, like, he just, like, they look at each other for a second, and then they just, like, awkwardly, like, get a little closer.
Yeah.
And they get a little closer, and then they start, like, making out, and it's like, you guys don't even know each other's last names.
Mm-hmm.
I mean.
That was their kiss. Let's get into the details of the kiss.
Yes. Jump ahead.
So, their kiss was awkward, and it kind of came, I blame both actors a little bit on this.
Okay.
They needed to work out, how is this going to happen? Because they did this awkward, like, middle ground where, like, Preston tried to rush in, and it made him seem a little creepy.
A little bit.
Then Jennifer Love Hewitt seemed a little timid, and then he kept pursuing, like, the kiss. He kept getting closer in the shot, and it was like, no, she's not ready for the kiss yet. And then then she finally, like, relents and goes in for the kiss, and it's like, oh, okay, that's weird. And then he has this weird smile on his face when they pull away, and she has this, like, kind of dramatic look, you know, the Jennifer Love Hewitt, like, smolder look.
Oh, yeah.
And then he's got this goofy smile on his face, and I felt like it just didn't match. I was like, dang it. Preston,
shoot.
Why are you high right now? You would have made better choices if you could have been off of the drugs. Get off the marijuana, kid.
I mean, yeah, it's hard because I get that, you know, you have this whole movie about these two characters, and you want to have some sort of a closure, but... I mean, could we have, like, panned ahead, like, okay, they're getting coffee, and now they're saying goodbye, and now there's, like, can we, like, fast forward, like, at least 20 minutes?
Sure.
Like, but, I don't know. It's the you know, cliches, yep, I get it. Mm-hmm. We're there.
Any other cameos you'd like to go into?
I mean, there's just so many people. There's,
it's crazy.
Like, Sean Patrick Thomas is in it, looking cute.
Yeah. Selma Blair's in it?
Selma Blair's Those in two, it for, and- like, and she... When did they do Cruel
They're
going to
do Cruel Intentions in a year.
Oh, yeah, they both are.
They're both in that movie together.
Oh,
they play
gosh.
Opposite of each other.
Yeah, this movie is just like a who's who of late 90s, early 2000s. You will see everyone in this.
It's wild.
Everyone
it's
is
so
in this
crazy.
Movie. It's so great.
Yeah, and the producers have said that, the writer-director, they've mentioned that they seriously had such a who's who of future celebrities in this movie.
Mm-hmm.
And they really attribute it to just like this, the dearth of teen movies at the time, and that they had every teen under the sun who auditioned for this movie that was in Hollywood at the time. And so they just got their grade A choices right off the press.
Yeah.
And so, I mean, all they needed was like Ryan Phillippe, Josh Hartnett, Sarah Michelle Gellar, like at the party and stuff.
Freddie Prinze.
Yep. They would just been rolling in it.
Can I say, I like that you used the word dearth twice now.
Have I? I used it the first time?
Yeah, you used it twice.
I don't know if you've heard. I'm getting my second master's. It's very impressive. But yeah, there's all kinds of crazy, crazy people. I mean, we've already mentioned Jason Segel. And then there's so many characters that you just like, you recognize them, but you don't know how you know them.
Yep. Yep.
Well, Jenna Elfman's in this movie, Dharma and Greg. She plays like this angel stripper.
Yeah, I only know her as Dharma, but yes. Yep. She's this kind of like this, angel person comes down, sets Preston straight on some stuff.
Mm-hmm.
I really enjoyed that character.
I forgot about
that moment because she's kind of just like sets him straight. It's like, you know what? Fate is fate.
Yep.
You wanted to be in love with Barry Manilow? You can be in love with Barry Manilow. Sorry, that's
funny.
An inside joke.
Inside
I mean, spoil
joke.
It
yep. He's trying to get a hold of Barry Manilow to ask for advice on what to do about Amanda. Hey, a random cameo I bet you didn't guess. Jan from Greece was in this movie.
Was she the one who was cutting the paper snowflake in the kitchen?
No, she would have been too old for that. She was the teacher who introduces Amanda at the very beginning of the movie.
Oh!
Yeah, I was like, who's got to walk her around?
Oh, you mean the actual actress who played Jan from Greece in the movie. I thought you meant just like someone on Broadway who played Jan from Greece.
Oh, no.
Oh!
Yeah, the original Jan in Greece movie.
The
is
OG Jan.
The OG Jan. You played Jan.
I did play Jan in Greece. But
very miscast.
Nah, I killed it. I love that role.
You did great. You did great.
I got to eat on stage, which, you know, as a young aspiring actress, that's when you know you've made it, when you get real food on stage.
Yeah, but when your Jan looks like Jennifer Love Hewitt, that's a problem.
Oh, Preston.
What? Well, I think this is a good time to take a short break our sponsor this week.
Great.
Preston's Pop-Tarts. Eat too many, and you just might not feel your legs.
Strawberry's my favorite.
Preston's Pop-Tarts. It's fate.
He did like strawberry. That was from the movie. That was legit.
Yeah, I know. And thank you so much to Preston for...
Thank you to Pop-Tarts. Pop-Tarts, really, yeah. Is who we should be thanking.
For sure.
For fake sponsoring
the
us.
The money that has been rolling in on our sponsorships have been out of this world. Thank you for everyone.
We're going to quit our jobs.
And then it will always be summer. Summer's off all year round, baby. So the original movie name, the title for this movie, the original movie name
yes,
was The Party.
Oh.
That's so lame.
So lame.
Come on.
Oh, The Party.
So it was called Can't Hardly Wait, though, because it was a song that the creators really enjoyed from a band called The Replacements. I was playing this song a little earlier, and
yeah,
I was like, do you know this song at all? And you're like, no.
I did not.
It's like over 5 minutes long. It's just like this old... Grunge Baller Ty was really into it because it's a little grunge inspired,
sure.
You know?
So, yeah, a little alt.
Ballin'.
Gotcha.
Yep.
No, I love the title, Can't Hardly Wait.
I do too.
I don't really know what it means, but I love
it. It's provocative.
It's provocative.
No one does.
It makes me think. For what?
When they were trying to film this bad boy, it was like a constant party on set. And in fact, they had to have special wranglers because they had so many extras that were always partying, always drinking.
Gosh.
And they would have to calm down the shoots and be like, all right, guys, we're getting ready to shoot now. Everybody needs to stop.
Yeah.
Stop
be
being
quiet.
So wild. Mm-hmm. And several of the producers and people and the crew members who had worked on this film, because this was the director's first film they'd ever done, both of those guys.
Oh, my gosh.
The guy and the gal. And they would be like, this isn't how it usually goes. Just so you know, like, this isn't typical of a film set.
Uh-huh.
And so they just didn't have a strong... like thumb on the pulse of the
know,
movie
like, what to,
to
do.
Know what was going on, and it would just get crazy on set.
Oh my gosh.
It was just a party.
That makes so much sense. I mean, I don't know how you would choreograph the insanity that is this house party.
Yeah.
So that makes, what a nightmare
yeah,
to direct.
Sure.
What a blast to be a part of, but a nightmare to direct.
Yeah, I think this is a movie that as an extra, you would have so much fun.
Because yeah, you're in such stories.
You're in close quarters with all these huge stars or soon to be stars.
Yeah.
That you can be like, I was on set with that person. Yeah, we like
yeah,
talked
we hung
for a
out.
While.
We hung
out for a few
like
days.
8 hours.
Yeah. For sure. You know those stories would happen in a set like this.
Yeah.
Because it's all in a big house pretty much.
Mm-hmm.
I don't think it was a studio set. It looks like it's just let's find a house and let's start shooting.
Yeah.
They did not want to have an R rating for this film. So this is where
is this rated R?
No, it's PG-13.
Oh, okay. I was like, I don't
they
think
have
so.
An F bomb in it.
Yeah,
but they're,
I think you get one.
You get one. So they're okay.
Use it wisely.
Yep. But this movie is a precursor to American Pie that's coming soon.
Yep. Okay.
And so they did not want the PG-13 thing. Mm-hmm. And so they eliminated a lot of things from the movie.
Okay.
So this movie was originally, the producers, which I think was Columbia Pictures, they wanted no alcohol in the movie. They said there can be no underage drinking.
Uh-huh.
How do you do a movie about a party? This is Jennifer Love Hewitt who said this in an interview with VH1. She's like, how the heck are we supposed to do a party movie with no drinking?
Yeah.
Like, that doesn't even make sense.
Yeah.
They also wanted parental figures at the house the entire movie. They wanted like a parental figure who was trying to calm things down.
Sure.
Who was like the voice of reason, but then just never was able to succeed.
Yeah.
So lame.
No.
You can't have
it
that.
That's not the story that we want to tell.
For sure. So what they made a deal and they said, we're going to show as little actual alcohol on camera as possible.
Okay.
We'll leave it up to the audience's imagination. So
sure.
They agreed. So they did tons of red Solo cups. I don't know if you noticed that throughout the movie. Tons
yeah,
of cups where you don't know what it is. But
well, anytime
what's coming
I see
out
a
of
red
that
Solo
cake, it could be
cup.
Root beer. It was a root beer cake.
Yes, it could be a root beer
1919
cake.
Has those root beer
except
cakes.
For the line where he says, the beer has gone bad.
It's terrible. Nobody drink the beer. The beer has gone bad.
There's that.
Yeah, William says that's really funny.
It's really funny.
Oh, the beer has gone
it's terrible.
Bad. Stay away from the beer. Another thing that they wanted to do, though, because they had already filmed so many shots with certain alcoholic paraphernalia that they had to then go back and they had to CGI, and this was really expensive.
CGI?
The most expensive part of this movie was CGIing out alcoholic paraphernalia after they had filmed the movie.
Whoa.
Some of the stuff they CGI'd out, I pointed it out to you during the movie. Do you remember what they were?
Yeah, there was a grapefruit.
Or a lemon.
A lemon in someone's hand.
William has a lemon in his hand.
And a salt shaker. I mean, I assumed I knew what he was doing, but...
It looks like maybe you just took a shot and you... And you did that. Mm-hmm. What it really was, there were two beers.
Oh!
He was double-fisting beers. And they edited that out.
Okay.
And then...
Because a salt and the lime are, like, so much, like, less provocative. Like...
Leave it to the imagination. Maybe he's just doing lemon squirts.
Salty,
and then he's
citrus. So good.
And then the other thing that happened in the movie that took a ton of CGI. When Jennifer Love Hewitt first walks into the movie, and then there's a shot later on in the movie with Jennifer Love Hewitt.
You mean the moment when she walks in, it's like slow motion and everyone turns
yes.
to look
and
at her?
The
it's
lighting,
iconic.
The lighting even changes, and you can tell they put a little
yeah,
fan on her
like
hair because her hair billows a little
cool
bit.
That cool song,
beautiful.
Like, it's like this like moody something. I don't know what song it is, but it's great.
Oh my God, I can't believe she came.
Now, she looks super hot in that opening shot.
Mm-hmm.
But what did I tell you in the movie when we were watching it?
I don't remember.
I said towards the end of the movie, she just has a ponytail and a t-shirt on.
Oh, yes.
And I was like, oh,
way
primo.
Way cuter without
primo.
Her. Her hair is a bit teased
yes.
in this. And I didn't remember that being a hairstyle at that time, but apparently it is.
Well, in that first opening shot, that iconic look,
yep.
there's a guy in the background and he's holding a balloon. And he has a smile on his face.
Ugh.
The smile is CGI'd and the balloon is CGI'd because what it was originally is he had a beer bong holding above his head and then it had like a line down to his mouth and he's chugging a beer bong.
Oh my gosh.
And then
gosh.
Later, in the same exact shot, not the same exact shot, but it's when she's talking to Preston in the backyard.
Yeah, yeah, there's that
there's
red
a balloon
again.
Nope, it's the beer bong again. He's doing another bong.
Yeah, you were like, okay, watch that balloon. And I was like, what? Is this like a it thing? Like, or is there like a homage? Like, what's going on with this creepy red balloon floating in the back here? Wow.
Yeah.
That was some good CGI.
Mm-hmm.
I wonder how much that cost back in the late 90s.
Seth Green says that was crazy expensive for that time period, that they spent more money on that than anything else in the movie. Just CGIing out that beer bong and those two beers,
like
the double
shot
fist
it and be like, hey, you get out of here. We're just going to do that shot again where you walk in really slow, J-Love.
I don't know. And they just must have thought they nailed it, you know?
Gosh, that's so... And I'll be honest, like, to what end? Like, because a beer bong makes me think that was any less of a crazy party. Like, we already know that was a rager. It's an insane party.
Yeah.
Right? And so... Now I think that you weren't drinking at it because a floating balloon was...
I don't know. Columbia and Sony had their fingerprints all over dumbing down this movie in certain
I'll
capacities.
Be honest. Maybe they should have taken out a couple of F-bombs
yeah.
and a couple of homophobic slurs, and maybe that would have made it a little less
well,
cringy.
You'll think this is interesting. The whole cops coming in and mm-hmm. seeing the guys with their shirts off when William and...
Yeah, there's like a stage thing where... Yeah.
The nerd mm-hmm. and the jock... They mm-hmm. are
caught in an embrace.
Yeah. They get chloroformed by the nerd buddies.
Yeah, blah, blah, blah.
Yep. And these police officers come in and they're like, what's going on here? This is horrible or whatever. And then they go to the jail and
yeah.
there's a conversation with the cop that mm-hmm. happens in the jail between the cop and the nerd. That whole thing was added in because Sony said, we have to have a parental figure talk about how this was bad.
Mm-hmm.
And so they added in this stupid scene. So while I was watching it, too, I was like, this does feel out of place.
Mm-hmm.
These cops coming in and then this jail scene. It just seems stupid.
Someone needs to have some consequences for their actions. I don't disagree, Sony. I don't disagree.
Yeah, but it was lame. Another thing that they had to take out was William the nerd. He dances. And this is when he becomes super popular. He gets wasted during the party.
Uh-huh.
And he dances to, what is it?
Paradise City?
Yeah, Paradise City. And originally, he was supposed to be dancing to a Van Halen song. And if you watch his mouth during that scene, He's mouthing different words. I caught it because I knew about this.
The song?
They changed the song and they just tried to match it where his mouth looks like it kind of is saying what he's supposed to be saying. But he is not dancing to that song and singing the lyrics to it. So then they dubbed in like his voice singing to the microphone and then him dancing around is not at all to that.
As an actor, I would have been so upset because I'd be like, hey, you made me look like a goof. Like, I could have danced. I mean, I know it works for his character, right? But, like, I could have looked so much cooler had I known that we were doing Paradise City. Like, I have some moves specifically for that song that I never got to use.
Paradise City is an infinitely danceable number. Yeah. Like, you could just really kill it.
Paradise City. Like, yeah. Oh, yeah.
Oh, it's great. There is a scene in the movie where Jennifer Love Hewitt's buddies, they compare her to an actress. Who do they compare her to?
Oh, they compare her to Gwyneth Paltrow. They say she's so much better looking than Gwyneth.
Yes. So they...
And Mike Dexter's no Brad Pitt.
No Brad Pitt. Can't even sniff the same air as Brad. So they chose to do Gwyneth Paltrow because Gwyneth Paltrow was Jennifer Love Hewitt's idol. She loved Gwyneth Paltrow.
Of course she did.
That's who she looked up to.
Of course she did. As any self-respecting actress in the 90s would.
I feel like that's a great idol to have, Gwyneth Paltrow.
I'm not being facetious.
No, I agree with you.
I'm 100%, bro.
I'm on Jennifer team Gwyneth and Gwyneth.
Yeah, I'm on their team.
I'm on,
I would like to be on their team.
Do you want
to
be friends with them too?
Absolutely. What do you mean two?
Oh, I'm already friends with them. Yeah, we hang. It's pretty fun.
Yeah, that's a great... Especially 90s, like heyday.
Yeah. Now I'm going to tell you a couple things that are going to depress you about Preston.
More stuff.
Yeah, well, we're not even tipping.
I like how you broke
tip
it
of the
into
iceberg,
two sections.
Baby. Tip of the iceberg.
We
nope,
didn't have
there's
to do
more
it all
after
at
once. This that we'll get to later.
Well, that is. I take back what I said about calling you a Preston earlier.
Well,
I'm sorry
you can call me
hurt,
a Preston, but just not. I'm not the actor. So, okay. There is the big kiss scene that we already talked about and how it kind of is awkward a little bit.
Yes.
Jennifer Love Hewitt,
yep.
She knew that, what's the guy's name? I don't remember. But that he,
not Preston.
Embry, that he is a huge pothead.
Yeah.
And she didn't really like being around him that much.
Sure.
And kind of as a joke, but like truthfully at the same time, she thought he smelled like marijuana all the time on set.
Mm-hmm.
So to his trailer, she sent him a bouquet of breath mints and for right before their kissing and said, these are for you. Please take them before we do our scene. And he kind of jokes around about it. He's like, yeah, I was such a party boy and everything. Like, she sent you these breath mints. What a goober. I would feel like such a goober if Jennifer Love Hewitt, one of the hottest stars of our time period.
I know.
She sends me a bouquet of breath mints before our kiss scene because I stink like marijuana all the time and she's worried about it. Like, I feel like such a loser.
I'll be honest. That should have been his, like, bottoming out. Like, that... should have been where he turned it around and he said, like, today I'm a new man.
No.
I'm giving up the weed.
Let me tell you, it
as
didn't
they
work.
Say.
Well, it didn't turn him around as a human being because this part really bums me out. So the Embry was asked by the directors, that letter that you give Amanda, what is in it? It has to be powerful enough to make her try to find you.
Mm-hmm.
It's like strong enough that she doesn't want to be with anybody else besides you. What could possibly be in it? And they asked Embry that.
Mm-hmm.
And they, you know, general coaching, general acting, deep dive into backstory, given circumstances.
Acting.
Can you just, like,
what's your
decide?
Thinking?
Yeah,
what
what's
your
in the letters? And they even had suggested maybe you write a little something and Jennifer Love Hewitt could actually read it. And Embry's response was this. He said, who cares? It's a prop. Give her that prop. That's all that matters. She can figure out what it is if she knows how to act.
Oh, man. Not a team player.
No.
I don't like this guy.
I don't either.
I don't really like... He sounds like a real jerk.
For sure. He really does. He doesn't sound like a Preston to me.
No. And I don't feel bad about talking about his receding hairline anymore.
You shouldn't.
I don't.
You shouldn't. And he looked like one of my really good buddies, Ryan Henderson. And I was like, he looks just like Ryan right there.
He's like a big sweetie.
And now, Ryan, you're way cooler than this guy.
Whoever Emery.
He's a loser.
Oh, man. That is Bumsville.
Mm-hmm. So this movie gets released in June of 1998. That's between 5th and 6th grade for us in the summer.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't think I saw it anywhere near when it got released. I figured I didn't see it for a few more years. When did you see it? When was it in your grandma's collection? Did she get it right away?
Well, it wasn't in grandma's VHS collection, but it was on that side of the family that I saw it. My cousin, my older cousin, Vanessa... introduced me to this movie. And so she was always kind of like my in to like, hey, what should be cool? Like she knew all about Buffy and, you know, all those things.
Oh, gotcha.
Dawson's Creek. She was always ahead
She's
of her
so
time.
Cool.
She was really cool.
She watched Buffy and Dawson's Creek. She's the coolest.
She is the coolest. And it would have been in middle school. It would have been, maybe seventh grade for me. So quite a bit later. So it was a VHS that we watched it. So it had been released already.
So the movie had a $10 million budget. It made $8 million on opening weekend. And it made $25 million overall. So made its money back.
Mm-hmm.
Not a huge, astounding financial success, but it made its money back.
Yeah.
There were some figures that had it like in the hundred millions. And I'm like, I don't believe that. Box Office Mojo says it's only 25, you dirty liar. Rotten Tomatoes gave this movie a 42%.
Ooh.
Yeah.
So not fresh.
Not
Which
fresh.
I guess like it makes sense that it's not fresh. I don't know.
Here, let me give you some
Let
me give you some of the stuff. Occasionally clever and moderately intelligent, Can't Hardly Wait also contains too many cheap laughs, recycled plotting, and flat characters.
Mm.
Here's what the Entertainment Weekly says. A high-spirited, synthetically raucous? Yeah,
raucous?
raucous house party comedy. Need I remind you, I'm getting my second master's. And then the Seattle Times says, the majority of the film is mired in magazine cliches and tired gags.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, look, a foreign exchange student who only knows how to say he's a sex machine. Ha, ha, ha. And the nerd's getting drunk, too. Ha, ha, ha.
I mean... When you say it like that, yeah, I know.
I
hear what you're saying.
I mean, it's the same as American Pie. It has all those same...
This was one of the first times I saw that, though, so that wasn't a cliche for me yet.
Yeah, maybe
just
the 80s kids, they were sick of it.
80s kids and, you know, kids in the 70s, you probably had your own movie, too, that was all of this. But I hadn't.
Yeah.
This was my first exposure to... Oh, high school's so cool.
Party high school movie. This is our movie.
It
kind of was.
Except, like, were you ever at a party that was like this in high school? I was never at a party like this. Even in college, I'm trying to think
In college, I was.
Yeah?
Not this crazy,
probably.
But really busy, really crazy stuff
like some,
happening.
Yeah. But not, not for high school for me.
Yeah, no, not for me either. In fact... I never drank at any parties. I never drank in high school. But when I went to a couple parties and then I had to like get out of there quick because you're always worried you're going to get busted and you're going to be the one kid who wasn't drinking and gets in trouble.
I know. That's what they always warn you about. You're going to be that one kid.
But those parties were always really tame. They were always kind of like chill. Everybody was just like around a bonfire or like sitting in the kitchen. And I was like, oh, this is what it is.
Yeah.
This is that cool.
Yeah.
You had nothing.
No, I didn't really go to... any parties
even
in
college you didn't have like
in college,
a crazy
yeah.
what's
no.
your you have a craziest house party story?
I'm trying to think of a house party that was crazy, like not like out of control, but like we had like silly house parties where like we dressed up for themes and stuff. Like my 21st birthday was like an 80s theme, and
sounds awesome.
It was so great. We had we had a punch bowl, a fountain that had mixed drink coming out
How'd
of it.
How'd you do that?
One of the gals I was friends with, her parents had like a catering business and they let us use it. It was so fun.
Oh my gosh.
Of course, like the drink though that we had mixed in it had like some pulp in it or something, so it kept getting like clogged. So they had to like clean it out a little bit, but
gosh.
And then this like delicious like orange juicy thing kept like spilling out. It was great. But like, I mean, that would have, from the eyes, it would have looked crazy, but like, I mean, our houses weren't destroyed after it.
I told you about, this was before I went to college. This was right after I graduated high school. I went to that jungle juice party with the jungle juice in the bathtub that you always hear about, which is so gross.
That's so disgusting.
And there was fruit in it. And it was just, it was, when I think back on it,
using
horrifying.
A bathtub to house the booze, like not even getting like... a container.
Yep.
Like a plastic container that can be washed out easily and sanitized and no one ever has to put their dirty butt in it.
You just go walk into the bathroom, you take a scoop.
Oh, there's so much hair!
I assume they washed it out.
Yeah, but still.
Hey, you want to know the craziest part of this story?
College kids cleaning.
I'm not going to get too in-depth because I don't want to get anybody in trouble, but it was the son of a cop.
No.
And his dad was gone.
Oh, jeez.
Yeah.
Oh, jeez.
So, take that for what it's worth.
Can you imagine being that kid's dad and hearing over the radio, like, so-and-so, we've got a blah, blah, blah at this address. Like, oh, my God, that's my house. I'm going to kill him.
Did you have any sort of graduation party when you guys graduated?
Graduation party, like seniors or something?
Yeah.
Like,
yep. For your class.
No. Not like a collective thing. I know people like went out and partied.
But you didn't even have like something the school organized?
No. We were kind of a lame class too. Like we didn't really. I told you what our prom stuff was.
What was your prom thing?
When the sun goes down.
Oh, yeah.
A Kenny Chesney song.
And I told you, Mars was something about the stars, but I don't remember what it was. It was Rewrite the Stars from Greatest Showman.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
Wow.
It was really cool. We were really ahead of our time. Zac Efron actually he Skyped in, but he was there. We had Skype, too. That was really crazy.
We had Skype.
2005. We had Skype. It was right off his MySpace page. But in my junior year, it was Unforgettable.
That's a fun
I know,
theme.
Very classy.
I think that's really classy, and I'm jealous of...
What's the When the Sun Goes Down song?
When the sun goes down, we'll be grooving when the sun goes down.
Lame.
I know. I'm jealous of...
Might as well have had a Kesha graduation theme.
I'm jealous of classes who like kind of like seem like they had it together or were like joined in some ways. Like my class wasn't, but I think classes after me, I definitely felt maybe sometimes even more connection to,
mm-hmm.
Or they just like felt like more cohesive as a group. And so, yeah, it just makes me sad. Like, cause they're definitely, it's not that we didn't have cool people, cause we did. There are some like really great people, but I think they just got washed over by the pops.
Sure.
The pop kids.
So we were like the most stereotypical bunch of graduating kids in 2005.
Mm-hmm.
And you guys had cooler songs and stuff for your graduation song. Like what was my graduation song? It was Vitamin C's graduation song. What was the song at after grad party at Lewis Bowl or whatever? And we're like all huddled around and we all have our arms around each other, which is a really sweet moment. What are we singing? Time of My Life from Green Day.
Mm-hmm.
Like it's just so stereotypical. Yeah. 2005.
Oh yeah.
What was your graduation song?
I didn't have a graduation song.
Oh, you didn't have one?
No.
Did you guys just sing that one song?
No.
From Cruel Intentions? You know what I'm talking about?
No.
Good podcasting.
This is great. I think we're keeping all of our listeners enthralled right now.
Yeah.
No, we didn't have a graduation song. We just sang like America the Beautiful and stuff.
Or
whatever choir song we learned that year.
I like to think that you guys did it all because you were really big into jazz choir. So instead of having a band lead you guys in with Pomp and Circumstance, you guys did it jazz choir-wise.
Oh, Colorblind. That's the song.
Colorblind, yeah.
No, we didn't sing Colorblind yet. We should have.
Somebody, I thought
we probably did it at our... Sorry, this is not interesting for anybody to listen to. We probably did it at our like our choir thing for seniors, but like at the whole graduation ceremony itself, no, we probably just sang other songs.
Okay.
All right, let's get off of this.
You didn't do any jazz choir?
Making fun of jazz choir. It was awesome.
I know.
It was the best hour of
our
my
life.
Our
listeners don't know this, but I recently went on a nice rant making fun of jazz choirs like a week ago. It was awesome.
And I feel 100% victimized by this.
But the funny thing is, you didn't even rebuttal about show choir, which is the easiest target ever.
That's because I didn't do show choir. We didn't have a show choir. Jazz choir was show choir for us. We didn't have it, so.
Losers.
No, you're the losers.
We had jazz choir as well, but we sucked at it.
I would have loved it had we had it.
You would have loved show choir.
I'm sure. But instead, I love jazz choir. It's fate, Ty. Fate.
Wow, it's fate.
Wow.
Hey, did you notice that klepto kid stealing stuff the entire movie?
Yeah, I thought he was great.
He's
also another cameo. Whoever that kid
is,
he's in lots of movies. Lots of movies around this time.
Yep, for sure.
He's a really weird-looking kid.
He really is.
Unique. I shouldn't say weird. He just has a very unique look. You'll know him.
Hey, maybe he's like super buff now. He's like Carrot Top transformation. You know,
yeah.
He got crazy ripped.
He could have been.
Hey, do you think Carrot Top...
Wait, what? Where are we
How
going?
How do you feel about his transition from string bean to one of the buffest people I've ever seen in my life?
I don't
think that's a natural transition.
No. He had to, I'm sure he did roids or something to get to where he was at.
He got crazy.
He just has had a weird look that worked for him, and then it got weird in a just a whole nother way. Do people even know who Carrot Top is anymore? Like, where did we go with that?
He's a stand-up comic who had crazy gizmos
and
gadgets.
We don't need to explain it.
Yeah, I'll be honest. I don't want anybody to go watch any videos or anything. So
we're just going to cut out the last 10 minutes of this because we've just been nowhere.
Hey, I really miss in rom-com tropes, especially like high school ones, where they would show, you mentioned this already, with like the picture and the text, but even at the end of movies where they give like a little textual breakdown of what happens to the characters afterwards.
Sure. Mm-hmm.
I think that's so fun.
Mm-hmm.
And it's a snapshot of a time period, but I think that we can bring it back.
Yeah, I'm all right with that. I love to know what happens to these characters next. And a lot of times it's usually pretty funny.
Yeah.
And yeah, it just makes you feel like, all right, I can rest now.
Mm-hmm.
I know what's going to happen. And your character will get their just rewards.
I also really enjoyed the music in this movie. I mean, it's very much a snapshot.
Oh, it's so great.
Late 90s.
I love the music.
I really enjoyed how every time you hear a song that's playing in Preston's car when he's driving, or a song that he just hears randomly, it always reflects exactly what's going on in his mind, or it enforces his next choices.
Yes.
I think that's great.
Very Nora Ephron of...
Nora Ephron.
She's the director from... You've Got Mail.
Oh, yeah.
The music really propels the story forward.
Yes. I bet she stole that concept.
I'll be honest. I think I gave her too much credit. This was probably like one of my mistakes that I made. I just took like a little blip off of Wikipedia and I said it for fact. This is what she was famous for.
Oh, do you ever
like
think,
nobody has ever thought to do that.
Do you ever think in this podcast that if anybody associated with a project listened to it, they'd be like, that's twisting the words of the reality of the situation.
Oh, 100%.
Yeah, I hope nobody of substance ever listens to this.
We're liable, like...
You slandered me.
Slandered.
That's not true.
That's not true.
I read it. I read it on IMDb trivia.
The internet said you did that. Yeah, what's his face? Preston Myers is going to come after us for all the slanderous talk we've had about him being a pothead.
Hey, I've got another thing, too.
Oh, another thing?
Yeah. Well,
oh, no.
So there have been talks about doing a sequel. And the idea for the sequel is all these characters have their 20-year reunion, and now they're all back, and there's a huge party the same night.
Wait, they're talking about the sequel now?
Yeah, they're talking about doing it now.
It's more than 20, isn't it? Wouldn't it be like 25 now for them?
I think you could get away with 20 years. Because it was 98, right, that it came out.
Yeah.
And so it's 2020 now, so 22 years. I think you could just...
You're right.
You could say 20 years, and it'd be fine. Everybody would buy it.
Yeah. Yeah.
And Jennifer Love Hewitt wants to direct it.
Will she be in it?
Yeah.
She'll be in it, too?
Yep. And there's a major push for this. She announced that they're like kind of in pre-production and development
now. No way.
In 2019.
I
can't hardly wait too.
Would be really excited about that.
And a lot of the characters want to come back.
Really?
But listen to this.
I'm shocked by that.
Embry, who plays Preston.
He's not invited.
They asked him. They're like, how do you feel about a sequel? And he goes, well, we all know what happens to these characters anyway. They have a couple kids. They get divorced. Preston now writes scary movies at his typewriter. And Amanda is a slut and sells her body for...
What?
To men for money.
Oh, my gosh.
Yeah.
Oh, my gosh.
He's brutal.
Let's not have him a part of it. I know that people will, like, be up in arms, but when they hear what he was like on set, I think they'll be like, it's okay. We'll go with someone new.
He told that in a VH1 interview.
Wow. What a punk.
Uh-huh. And then recently, he told Times, when it started to pick up more steam, he's like, well, I don't know. I guess the movie says they live happily ever after, so I suppose we would just assume that they're still together and everything, and... That's what the second movie would be about. And so he tried to like backtrack on his words or whatever, but he is kind of a little punk.
Yeah. And I'll be honest, like, why would you poo-poo that? You don't have anything else going on right now. Jennifer Love Hewitt is throwing you an olive branch
sir,
after your nasty, smelly weed kisses. Like, take it, sir.
For sure.
You have a chance to redeem yourself.
She could easily be with Clyde or whatever his name is from
Mike
Twilight.
Dexter.
Mike Dexter, who is,
oh crap, Carlisle.
Carlisle.
Oh my God, he's Carlisle.
She could be back
I'm
with Carlisle in a
that.
Second.
She would make a very sexy vampire.
See, and that guy, He wants the plot now to be about the title. The characters have switched, and Preston's now a big jerk, and who like is a millionaire of this company, and like.
Is he really?
Yeah, he pitched this whole idea. He's like, this is what the movie character should be about, and my character is now the loser who's down on his luck ever since he's fallen hard, and it's all about them switching roles pretty much, and me getting the girl back.
That's a little weird. I don't. Maybe I don't want this to be a movie.
Yeah,
maybe
I don't know.
We just leave
I'm
it
a little
where
cautious
at.
About it, though,
yeah,
to be honest.
Yeah, okay, I changed my mind. Leave it where it was at.
This movie is number 44 out of 50. This isn't a great rating of top 50 high school movies of all time by Entertainment Weekly.
I can't think of 50 movies about high school.
Super Bad, American Pie,
when did they start
Porky's.
This?
Breakfast at Tiffany's. Breakfast at Tiffany's.
Nope, that's not a real thing.
That's messed up.
I messed up.
All the John Hughes movies.
Okay. Breakfast Club?
Breakfast
is
Club
going
is
for?
I was really going. Breakfast at Tiffany's.
I was like, what was sir?
Hey, I've never seen Breakfast at Tiffany's.
I haven't either.
Great, we're going to get a lot of slack about
now
it.
Now we're going to get a lot of
what's growth. The one we were getting a lot of from? Oh, Harry Met Sally.
Yeah, we should have seen that.
Yeah, we're taking a lot of guff about that from people who've listened to the podcast.
I think
last
it's
week.
Probably fair, I'll be honest.
Yeah.
If it's, yeah. Maybe we'll start another one, like movies we've never seen.
But who does the research?
Beloved movies that we've never seen, and we'll tell you what we think about
They'll
them.
They'll just be short That's episodes good. Where they're like 10 minutes long. It's just like, here's what we thought, everyone.
We agreed. It's crazy. We haven't seen it yet.
So I have a lot of questions for you now.
Okay.
Number one.
More?
I want to talk about what's your favorite scene or part in the movie.
Okay. Oh. You said number one, and so I thought maybe you were going to tell me all the questions
first.
Number
two is after your answer.
Oh, okay. Thank you for clarifying. Oh, number one. My favorite part of the whole film?
Yep.
I mean, if I have to pick like just a moment, I love the iconic scene when she comes in, when Jennifer Love Hewitt's character comes into the party and the music changes and like everyone's like looking at her like, and they're kind of like whispering and you can just tell like she doesn't want to be there. She's like, oh, I just got broken up with and now everyone's talking about me. But it's just iconic. They make fun of it in Not Another Teen Movie.
Yep.
Which really borrows a lot from this.
Oh, for sure. This and She's All That.
Heavily,
like,
yeah.
A lot.
Yeah, and they even make fun of it, like, how long do we have to stare at her? Like, I don't know, she'll leave and then we can stop. Like, oh, that took a really long time that time. It's so great. I just remember that moment stuck with me. And like to think that that's like what happens when I walk into parties, you know, everyone's
with
like,
the undergrads?
Yeah, everyone turns like quiet, like, oh, she's there she is. And I'm just like looking around steely eyed.
They do
like,
say, there she, they say, who is that? Is they say, like, who is that girl?
Who's she?
That girl with tie?
She looks old.
Oh, that's his old bag of a wife, I heard.
The old ball and chain. Other gosh. Moments that I loved the random band that like broke up and then like said like, hey, should we get back for a reunion? And, like they've never played.
Yep.
They
never played a gig. And they're like, hey, let's get
always gets interrupted.
It's a mixture of some of the old stuff with some of the new stuff.
Anybody order a love burger? Well done.
Hey guys, what would you think about a reunion? Nothing big. A few new songs, mostly old stuff.
So great. I love that the popular boys are all like being convinced by the main popular boy, Mike Dexter. He tries to convince them like, hey, you guys should all break up with your girlfriends. And then we can be single in college and it'll be great. And they're all like, yeah, well, let's do it. And then they get to the party and they're like, no, maybe not.
Yep.
I just really want to, you know, we've got the house to ourselves tonight. And then like the next day when they're all after the fact, they're like, yeah, let's break up with them. Like they're just like such sheep. And
yep,
I love that whole like bit. I think it's hilarious.
Yeah. Absolutely.
Yeah, I don't know. I just love it really plays into the cliches, but I don't know. For me, this was the first one for me, so it kind of set the standard for what I compared all other, you know, early 2000s teen movies, like She's All That, 10 Things I Hate About You, I compared them all to this. And those actually were better movies, especially because they were based on Shakespeare, now that I think about it.
Let's be honest. I don't think 10 Things I Hate About You or She's All That is better than this movie.
Oh, see, that's debatable, especially 10 Things. 10 Things is pretty good.
I'm going to give you a hot take.
Hot take?
I think 10 Things is overrated.
Ooh.
Yeah. And I like Shakespeare, you know, obviously Taming of the Shrew is awesome.
Yeah, yeah.
But that movie doesn't do it for me.
Yeah?
Yeah. I actually think some of the acting kind of sucks.
Joseph Gordon-Levitt in there as like one of your mains?
Yep. I think JGL's good. I don't like Heath in it.
You don't like Heath in it?
I think he's kind of annoying.
Oh.
Yeah.
He was not a heartthrob for me in that. I think Julia Stiles is kind of annoying. Yeah.
Yeah, Heath has nasty teeth in that movie. Go back and look at his teeth and look at his haircut.
Yeah.
He looks kind of gross.
Yeah.
He gets hotter later on. Mm-hmm. And I think in that movie, he's kind of a gross human being.
Yeah, yeah. I don't completely disagree with that. I can see where you're going to get some heat, though.
And yeah, we are.
I'm not going to... I'm not going to hitch my wagon to this.
Oh, we're going to take some flack.
No, not we.
We are going to take some flack.
We're going to take some flack.
Everybody heard what you just said about Heath.
No, they didn't.
Yeah,
because
they did.
I will edit this out. No one will know what I said. Yeah, those are the moments that I liked.
Well, what are your favorite high school teeny bopper movies? For me, it's this one in American Pie. Are my two favorites.
American Pie.
I loved American Pie.
Oh, God.
I know. I loved it, though.
Of
I loved
you did.
It.
Such a boy
thing. I still watch it all the time.
Yeah, did you watch The Man Show, too?
It was on occasion. You know what I liked more than The Man Show?
Hmm.
Loveline, because it gave great advice.
I don't know what Loveline is.
Oh, you don't know what Loveline is?
No, it's
Loveline. It used to be on after The Man Show.
So that's how you saw it.
Yeah, so Dr. It's not Dr. Phil. It's Dr. whatever his name is, who was on The Man Show. You would recognize him if I showed you. He was this doctor guy.
Mm-hmm.
They'd bring him on for segments.
Yep.
And then he got his own show with Adam Carolla.
Mm-hmm.
And these people would call in with their love problems. Whether that was like sexual or whether that was relationship or mm-hmm. whatever they were, they would call in and Adam Carolla would usually make fun of them and say funny banter mm-hmm. back and forth. And then the doctor guy would give them actual advice. And I thought it was fascinating.
Yeah.
I used to watch that a lot. So, yeah, I did watch The Man Show on occasion, I'll have you know, but not a lot. I didn't really like it that much.
Yeah, can we talk about how, like, we've, like, forgiven Jimmy Kimmel for all of that?
For
like, all of a sudden, it's like, hey, let's just... I mean, and I don't have anything against him personally, but, like, as a host, like, he's, like, pretty, like, beloved, I feel like.
Mm-hmm. And people
like,
think of him as a good guy.
Yeah, but, like, we all, like, forget, like, remember that, like, really shady, seedy show that we all... I mean, granted, we all watched
women.
It. Yeah, it was awful. It was really awful.
Yep.
So, let's put that out there.
Mm-hmm.
Uh-oh. Jimmy Kimmel fans coming at me.
I got the Heath Ledger fans. You got the Jimmy Kimmel fans. Hey, Heath Ledger's great and very attractive when, he got much better looking.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah.
But Night's I'm just saying
Tale,
in that
Heath
movie,
Ledger.
Oh, yeah, super hot.
Smoking.
But in 10 Things, go back and watch it.
Not
take those
best.
Rose-colored glasses off. He's not that great of an actor in that movie, and he looks a little
I think
stuffy.
He's got, like, wrestling hair in it. It's, like, long, scraggly
it's always
brown
wet,
hair.
Too. Yeah.
It's gross.
Yep,
yeah.
It's greasy.
Okay. So favorite teen movies, I'll just throw out a couple. I love She's All That. I like 10 Things I Hate About You. I can't really think of others. I know there's so many more.
What do they have now? What are the kids who are coming into college, what are their teen movies?
I think, can't say this for sure, but Booksmart was kind of a teen movie.
Yeah.
And
is that one that you heard a lot of people talk about, though?
I don't talk to a lot of high schoolers, so I don't know what you want me to...
What are the murmurs with the high school kids?
What are the kids? What are the kids talking about?
What are the kids watching?
I think that. I think they watched... oh, crap. To All the Boys I've Loved. It's like a Netflix movie.
Yeah,
they've done
that. Was that like a romantic comedy like a thing?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
I didn't know if that was just dramatic
sequel.
Or not.
They did a sequel for it. I don't know, probably 13 Reasons Why. Like,
that's dramatic, though.
I know. I'm just throwing things out. Kids watch so much stuff. Like, I don't even know. Can they even sit down for a whole movie anymore?
That's a good point.
They're just a bunch of YouTubers and TikTokers. They only have the attention span of, like, 5 minutes. Sorry.
That's true.
Sorry, I just offended a lot of people.
We are.
Like,
hey,
I mean, when was the last time you sat down for a movie?
We talked about a podcast at one point called Minnesota Real, where we don't sugarcoat anything and you get, like, our most base reactions
we're
to things.
Jerks.
I feel like whenever we get into one of these segments, we're going to be like, all right, it's time to get Minnesota real.
Minnesota real.
Just so in case you're not from Minnesota, it's a play on Minnesota nice.
Yeah.
Or Minnesota
real.
Which
is passive aggressive.
Yeah. Minnesota nice, passive aggressive. We're aggressive aggressive. We're Minnesota real.
We're not passive about our aggression.
Who was your favorite character in the whole movie?
Oh, my gosh. My favorite character in the whole... I mean...
Mm-hmm.
Okay, can I ask you that while I think?
Well, and mine's Preston. I'll pretend it's so like I'm obvious. Listening.
I like Preston too, but I'll be honest, all that stuff you told me just now, like, really kind of shaded it.
Forget about Embry.
I can't. I cannot separate them in my head any longer.
His performance, I came in with those judgments after doing the format right before we started the movie.
Yeah.
And he won me back over with his performance. I think he's so charming. He's so sweet. He's such a sweetheart that it like didn't ruin the movie for me. But yeah, he's a jackass.
I do like his character. I also really enjoy William Licker. What's his name? The nerdy nerd.
Yep, who worked for the Obama administration.
Yeah, I love his whole like rock star. I just think it's so fun. And how he becomes best friends with this terrible bully, you know, that the most popular guy, like they, I just, that's great. I'll stop with those two.
Okay. What'd you think about the acting?
I thought the acting was good.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know. I mean, they're high schoolers at a party. I'll be honest. I believed it.
Yeah, me too.
It looked like they were having a good time. Yeah. I didn't think anybody was. Now, I mean, there will be like some moments like I love J-Love. Don't get me wrong. But she has some things that she does.
She does.
She has like what you would maybe in your acting world call habituals, but like some like dramatic like looks and like blinks that she does.
Yeah. She also does like this exasperated sigh a lot where she's like, you know, there's something that I have to tell you about. She's just always doing this like exasperated outtake of breath that you're
it's fine. It works for me. You're gorgeous.
Yeah,
care.
You're so hot.
But I mean, for the most part though, I like the writing minus the homophobic slurs. I guess I could be careful there. I don't like the writing.
The F words are all great.
Yeah,
I love it.
I love it. It's great. Good. No issues there. I don't know. You have to have like, you know, what am I trying to say? You have to have like set expectations for what you're coming
sure,
into.
Yeah.
I understand that this is not a fresh movie. I get that. Critically wise, I totally get it. But it doesn't take away that I enjoyed myself and I really looked forward to it when you said that we were going to watch it. I was like, yes, I haven't seen this movie forever. Let's watch it.
Sweet.
Yeah. It's nostalgic.
So it's better than 42% for you?
Oh, yeah. For sure.
Yeah. Okay. I want to get into your rating in just a second.
Okay.
But first, I want to ask you, who were you in this movie?
Oh, man.
Because I think you can see shades of yourself in a lot of characters.
Yeah.
But I think there's for everybody who watches this movie, I think there will be a character that you relate to.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm curious to see who that is.
Yeah. I mean, there are aspects of J-Love's character when she's monologuing about who she is and not knowing who she is because it's always like wrapped up with like boyfriends and like if I'm not so-and-so's boyfriend, who am I? Like that hit home for me, my high school self.
Yeah.
And that hit home. I was like, whoa.
Mm-hmm.
Like just thinking that time. And I think on paper, as far as like what we were like in high school from activities and things like that, probably more her. But I think later on in high school, I kind of became a little bit more like, what's Preston's friend's name?
Sydney, I think. Lauren Lemke.
Yeah. Yeah. More of like, but not, because like she's at the party and she doesn't know anybody and she doesn't want to know anybody.
Yeah.
So it's not to that extent, but I don't know. You know what? I probably become more of a Preston.
Oh, her name is Denise, by the way, and it's Lauren Ambrose.
Yes. Gosh, all over the place. Oh, we're going to get yelled at for these things. Yes, I think I am a mix between, on paper, J-Lo, a little J-Lo. I'm J-Lo in
this
movie.
You're such a J-Lo. And I'm such a Shakira.
I'm a J. Love the cliche, but then I think later on in high school, I settle in and I'm more of a Preston.
Okay.
I'm more of a Preston.
You're more of a Preston.
I think I am.
A little bit romantic.
Well, just like kind of like a person that like everyone knew. I wasn't like the most popular person, but like, oh yeah, so-and-so. She's nice. Hope people said that about me.
She's hot is what they said too.
Like, well, Preston was hot. Let's not argue. Like he was really cute. He was cuter than any of the jocks except Sean Patrick Thomas, who I love.
He was even cuter than what's his name from Twilight?
Carlisle?
From Michael?
Yeah, he was.
Yeah?
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
Oh, Preston is completely 100% my type.
Yeah,
who
for sure.
Who he was in this movie is. And what he looked like.
He is your type.
Except in real life, because he was really a stoner. So then he's not my type. But
sure.
he was, but who he portrays in this movie was my type. So that's who I think.
So it's good I studied this movie then.
It was great
It's good
this
that this movie is so ingrained in my being.
Out. Do you think, obviously you related most to Preston. Is there another character that you have aspects, or do you just have blinders on with Preston?
Just blinders.
100% Preston?
I think so.
Yeah.
Yeah. That's who I was in high school too. Like,
yeah.
Well liked by a lot of people. A lot of, didn't really conform to a certain social group.
Yeah.
Was kind of on the outside.
Mm-hmm.
But like everybody, I think, enjoyed my presence.
Like, I would really like to say that. I said everyone said, oh, yeah, she's really nice.
Yeah, I think that's what they thought. But I wasn't the coolest guy ever. Like, they weren't like, gosh, Ty's the coolest.
No.
Nobody said Ty's the coolest.
I was,
but
no.
People said, like, I like Ty. Ty's awesome. Like, that was the general talk, you know?
The general consensus was, I was awesome.
I was awesome.
I was a cool guy.
Yep.
Or
but there were people who didn't like me. I mean, Preston was liked by everybody. There was people I got in fights with. So I was a fighter.
Yeah, you were a crazy kid.
Yeah, it was insane. So I want you to tell me, do you have anything that you'd like to get into before we get into your Rachel meter?
No.
Okay.
I was just going to ask you if you think there's another character in it that I was closer to.
That you were?
Yeah. Maybe one of the friends of
Maybe.
Maybe Melissa Joan Hart.
No, not Melissa Joan Hart. She has too much energy.
Yeah.
She's like
she
your
really
sister
does.
Tori. No.
I don't have too much energy.
No, I didn't mean it that way. So, you, maybe like one of the friends early in your high school career, because you said there were times where girls were mean girls and you just were a bystander.
Mm-hmm.
I would say then maybe one of the friends
yeah.
To Jennifer Love Hewitt. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Were you just a bystander?
I was a bystander
yeah.
Sometimes.
But then when you became part of, you really filled into yourself and like you knew who you were. I would say more of the other two. Yeah.
Okay.
Give me your Rachel meter.
All right. Would you want my Rachel meter first and then my consensus?
Yeah, do it like Rachel meter. Here's the consensus, like they do on Rotten Tomatoes. 42%. This movie is marred by trouble spots.
Okay. So I give this, because I enjoyed it, 89%.
Oh, yeah, you
it's
did.
High.
That's real high.
This is
for
the same
you, that's way high.
As like My Girl, it's around that area.
Wowzers.
Yeah. Yeah. I enjoyed it. It's just, it's so nostalgic for me.
Sure.
I can't separate that
nice.
From
I love it.
Who yeah what am I saying going on so here's my consensus. Some of the most clichéest of clichés, this film knows what it is and makes no apologies, but maybe it should to the gay community. 89%.
Nice, that's awesome. For me, I give it a low 80s.
Mm-hmm.
So it's, I think it's right at 80% for
okay.
me. Yep.
Wow. Interesting.
I love it.
Mm-hmm.
That's great. Well, that's all we have for Can't Hardly Wait.
Sweet.
Reminder to rate and review and maybe say hi to us on the Facebook page. Send us your old screen names. Send us a goofy picture of your terrible hair choices, and we'll do the same. And Rach, what's our third film going to be?
Yes. I am back in the driver's seat next week, picking a rewatch of another one of those great VHSs that I watched over and over at my grandma's house. The classic baseball film, A League of Their Own.
Ooh.
I'm so excited for this movie.
It's going to be good. Yeah. I can already tell you, we will love it. Don't expect any arguments. It's not going to happen. So we can't wait to hear from you then, though.
Yeah. Bye, guys.
Bye. Welcome back to...
No. Yeah, okay, this is a terrible start. This is terrible.